good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. People from every nation and from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. We worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. And you are good. Good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Oh, people from every nation and from generation to generation, we worship you. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Lord, you are good and your mercy endureth forever. Oh, people from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. We worship you.
Good morning, New Life Church. Hey, come on, I think you can do better this morning. I know we've lost an hour of sleep, but let's get ourselves ready to worship this morning. Good morning, New Heights Church. Good morning. Hey, we are so glad that you're here today, and the Lord is good. Can I get a witness? He's worthy of our worship, and that's what we're here to do this morning. And we got some first-time guests with us this morning. Church, would you give them a big welcome? Welcome them. Thank you for coming to our church. Thank you for being a part of here this morning as we worship our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. So we're going to begin that time just in prayer. If you would, just bow your head with me, bow our hearts, and let's get to that place where we hear the Lord. Father, you're good to us. You really are good, and you really are worthy of our worship, worthy of our praise. Father, we bring a lot of luggage in here this morning. We bring a lot of tiredness. We bring a lot of fatigue. We bring a lot of stress. We bring a lot of things that are not negative. Lord, we are needy, and you've created us to be needy because, Lord, you love, you enjoy providing for our needs. And so, Father, as we bring all of our junk in here this morning, may we lay it at your feet. May we lay it down. May we unhitch our wagon from that stuff, and may we be able to focus our hearts and our minds on you. And as we focus on you, Lord, draw us near to you. And as you draw, Lord, you're going to speak to us. May our hearts receive your word. May we be transformed by your Holy Spirit, and may we leave here joy-filled in you. And we pray that in the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. Amen.
Of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and just to be mindful of what we're singing to the Lord today. I always act like he's right in front of me, and that just does something for my heart.
Before I spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. You have been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it. But still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. So good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. And you have been so, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I found, leaves a 99. I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it, but still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, a mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't keep down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't keep down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves a 99. I couldn't earn it, and I don't deserve it, but still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending,
And now, as our ushers come forward, and we enter in this time of offering and a time of worship where we can give back what God has so graciously given to us, I just pray that this morning, as we think about how seasons change and the time changes, but our God remains the same. And that love that He has for us will always hold us in His hands and never leave us. So this morning, whatever God is leading you to give back to Him, which is already His, do it with a cheerful heart. That's what Scripture tells us. So join me as we pray over it now. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank You so much for this morning. Lord, in the ability to give back what is already Yours. God, help us trust You with every ounce of our lives, from our finances, Lord, to our families, Lord, and everything in between. God, we ask this morning, Lord, that You cleanse us of any sin that would hinder us from giving You a sacrifice of praise and worship. And Lord, that Your praise will always be on our lips, God. And in this moment, Lord, we will let all distraction fade away and focus on You and You alone this morning. In Jesus' precious and heavenly name we pray this.
I don't wanna miss one word.
Everything you say is life to me. And I don't want to miss one word you speak. So quiet my heart, I'm listening.
I'm listening.
Having children.
I put my hope in my health.
I put my hope in having the perfect marriage and having the perfect family. Experiencing infertility was difficult and lonely and sad, but I just kept clinging onto that hope that children were in my future.
I was in perfect health till I was 70 years old, and then suddenly things went south with stage 4 cancer and a variety of operations and so on, the most recent of which was amputation of my arm due to cancer growth. I've never been one to call on somebody to do something for me unless I had to.
Everything was on track, and all of my plans and hopes for my life were falling into place. And then about 2 months into my pregnancy, my husband told me he was done, and he wanted a different woman and a different life. All of my hopes and dreams for my life were broken. During the time of infertility, it was a time of hopelessness, wanting them so desperately and not being given that at the time that I thought was right. It was a constant reminder that you're not pregnant again, and you know, nothing seemed to provide the hope that I needed during that time. Listen, like, I got saved at 4 and like lived the perfect Christian life and went to Bible college and didn't have sex before I got married and did everything right. I didn't realize how far misplaced my hope had been.
My legs deteriorated. I couldn't use them. In the hospital for 4 months, I faced 2 near-death experiences. The question becomes, once that falls apart, can you still retain the hope and the strength that you need to see your way through that? They can take your ability to walk a straight line or even take your arm, but they cannot take your faith, they can't take away your hope, and they can't take your obedience to God. You hang on to that, and the rest of it falls into place.
There was no hope that this world was offering for me to have a child. But then I had rest in knowing he loved me enough to already have a plan for my life, whether that involved children or not. And hey, now we have 4 kids. And I wouldn't trade the life that I had, that I thought I had, this perfect life, for the actual relationship that I have with God now, to be on the other side enough to know that my hope is in my God. And I don't need to hope at anything else.
Oh, come on. Somebody help that young lady out. Would you get... Oh, well, so we're so glad you're here today. Welcome. You know, one of the things I want to do is our worship team kind of got a cog in the wheel at the last minute. Kenny and Brandy and some of the others couldn't be here this morning because of various things. And the 3 ladies stepped up and did it on their own. Would you show your appreciation for what they did this morning? And if you weren't blessed, I told them when they walked off the stage, I said, if I can't preach after that, I just can't preach. It's all about me at that point, you know. So we want to welcome you guys, and we got a few things I want to celebrate real quick and embarrass the people that I love the most. You know how it is. So I want to, Dean and Dina. Dean got baptized last weekend, and then Dean and Dina became one. They got married Thursday night after Celebrate Recovery. So let's give them a big welcome. Let's welcome them. So excited about that, and certainly want to celebrate big events, big moments in our life. Last week, we started a series called When Life Stinks. And what do you do when life stinks? How do you handle life when it just stinks, when it's bad? And we're going to do a 4-part series, 4 principles, 4 things that you can do, that you can apply to your life when life stinks. And so we talked last week about loving Jesus. Fred Cummings has ingrained this into my heart so much. I've been around him, and he, this is like his M.O. He says the biggest problem most Christians have is we're not enough in love with Jesus. And so last week, if you remember, that's where the title came from was from him. It's just his influence on my life is that we need to learn to love Jesus more. Can I get a witness of that? Jesus asking Peter, do you love me? How many times do you remember that? Do you love me? And how many times did you ask yourself that this week? Do I really love Jesus? You know, I hope a whole bunch. But that was the thought was, do you love me? We need to learn to love Jesus more. And so I want to get to our theme verse. I do this frequently. If this is your first time with us, I usually give us a theme verse whenever we do a series like this. And so it's a verse that I ask you to take to heart, try to memorize, try to apply it to your life. But it's in Deuteronomy chapter 30. And here's what it says. It says, this day I call the heavens and the earth as a witness against you, that I have set before you life and death, that I have set before you blessings and cursings. Now choose life. And so here's the reality. God has given us choices. God has given us an opportunity to choose. We get to choose. Are we going to choose life? Are we going to choose death? Are we going to choose blessings? Are we going to choose cursings? If you remember at the beginning in the garden, God placed all these trees there, and then he put one in the middle, and he said, look, you get to choose to eat from all these trees. Just don't choose this one tree. God is always about giving you and me choices in life. And so which will we choose? Which will you choose in your life? Will you choose life or death? Will you choose Christ, or will you choose self? Will you choose a life that brings glory and honor to Jesus, or will you choose a life that brings glory and honor to you? So when life stinks, we need to address some issues. When life stinks, we need to deal with the real problem. Come on, somebody help me out a little bit this morning, would you? When life stinks, we need to deal with the problem. When life stinks, we need to deal with the issues. Come on, somebody. Somebody, there we go. All right, now good. I did all that. I wanted to get you going because I want to set you up. You ready? That was a setup thing. Here's the setup. When life stinks, my biggest issue, now I'm just speaking for Mark Elkins. I'm not judging you, and if you agree with me, that's great. If you don't, it's okay. But when life stinks for Mark Elkins, Mark Elkins' biggest problem isn't my circumstance. Mark Elkins' biggest problem isn't that individual that seems to be my problem. Mark Elkins' biggest problem is my attitude. And the one thing that I can change is my attitude. And so today, what I want you to look at is your attitude. I really believe that we live in a place, I believe that we live in a time, a generation, an era, whatever you want, how you want to term that, where our attitudes as a whole are the worst. Can I get a witness? Anybody want to jump in there with me? And so when life stinks, the thing that we need to do the most is focus on our attitude. It's funny, this verse that I'm about ready to read, this verse that all this is based on, kept popping up on Facebook. And some of you were the ones that, and so you sort of influenced me with your Facebook post. But I want to preach or look at 2 Timothy chapter 3 and read that to you. And just kind of speak from when life stinks. It says, you should know this. This is Paul writing, Timothy, that in the last days there will be difficult times. Circle that, if you would, difficult times. For people will love only themselves and their money. They will be boastful and proud, scoffing at God, disobedient to their parents, and ungrateful. They will consider nothing sacred. They will be unloving, unforgiving, and they will slander others and have no self-control. They will be cruel and hate what is good. I ask you to circle the word difficult, and here's why. The word difficult is the same word used to describe the demoniac. You remember Jesus met this man that was full of this legion of spirits, and he cast him into the pigs. One of the words used to describe him was difficult in the original language. And so here's what that says to me. That says to me that we've got a people that often act in a way that resemble the demoniac. Do you know anybody like that? You know, in this day and time, when we act the way that we sometimes act, we're certainly not reflecting Christ. And so this verse motivates me to want to be different. When I read this verse, it encourages me to do something different. It challenges me. It calls me out. I want to be the opposite of this verse. Anybody else in here with me on that? I don't want to walk how this verse, I don't want this verse to be my epitaph at the end of my life. You know, I want to be different than this verse. And so here's the deal. The title of today's sermon is Make the Hard Choice. Make the Hard Choice. And so what I want to challenge you to do today is make the hard choice to be different. Make it a conscious effort. Put it on your mind that you don't want to be defined like this verse. And so I'm going to give you about four or five things that's not on the screen. It's not in your outline. If you got your, go ahead. If you got your bulletin, turn to the back. There's the outline there. You can be writing some of this stuff down. It's real simple. And then I've got 4 points after that. But the first one is this. Make the choice today to be thankful. In that particular passage, in that particular verse, you see the word unthankful. And I really focused on that for just a moment. And I meditated on that. What does it mean to be unthankful? You see, it's the mentality that our generation has that we're not happy with what we have. You know, it's about time for a new iPhone to come out. And when that new iPhone comes out, the phone you have right now, you're not going to be happy with. You're going to want the new one. Why? Just because yours is 6 months old, I don't care. That's not the best. I want the latest and the greatest, right? And so we have the tendency to be ungrateful for what we don't have. Anybody remember the Walkman? Raise your hand. You remember the Walkman? Remember how tough that Walkman was? Golly, you guys are old. That Walkman was tough, though. Do you remember? I mean, some of you probably still have yours, and it works. But today, things only last about 6 months because 6 months is about the time frame we want it. I mean, once it's at 6 months, it's done. You know, we're not interested in it anymore. And so have you ever noticed that the better off materialistically we are, the more unhappy we are? Have you noticed the more that we have, the more that we want? Have you noticed that the people who had less seem to have a happier life, a more joy-filled life? Why? The reality is it's a choice. Happiness is a choice. And I want to choose to be thankful. I want to make the hard decision today. And trust me, it's really not that hard. But I want to choose today to recognize how God has blessed me. I want to choose today to, instead of seeing what I don't have, recognize what God has. I've got clothes today. Some people don't. I've got shoes on my feet. We have warm places to stay, dry places to stay, cars. We have food in our refrigerator. We can take a breath. Do you know that some people can't breathe on their own? I mean, there's so much in our life that we need to be thankful for, that we can be thankful for. All we got to do is open our eyes and say, Lord, let me see it. Let me see you in my life. So I want to be thankful. The second thing is I want to be holy. The word in that passage was unholy. And so I started focusing on, what does it mean to be holy? The word unholiness, it emanates through this verse. There's a couple of words that just, man, they're saturated in this verse. But this text refers to a people who are boastful, a people who are proud, even to the point where they scoff at God, even to the point where they hate what is good. In our generation, we're willing to pollute holy things. We make choices. One of the most holy things that you have is your heart that's been changed by Jesus, right? And yet we pollute our heart. We fill it with music that shouldn't, with words that shouldn't be there, with ideas that shouldn't be there. We watch TV shows that put pictures in our mind that simply shouldn't be there. And so our biggest problem is this: sin. Now please understand this. Sin, this is why I'm saying this to you. Sin separates us from God. That's the whole point of sin. Why is sin wrong? Because it breaks the relationship with the Lord. And so anything that causes me to be cut off from God, I don't want to do with. I want to get that out of my life. And so choosing to be unholy is choosing to be away from the Lord. Making decisions that have sin in them comes with a cost. And that price is significant. The cost of sin is death. Romans tells us this, that the wages of sin is what? Death. The payment of sin in your life is death. And then it goes on to say the great thing about the Lord is he always gives us his answer. But the free gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Listen, in Genesis, God told Adam to eat of all the trees, but not to eat of the one tree. Why? Because they would die. Well, Adam and Eve just assumed that meant as soon as they ate it, they would die. And that's not what happened. What happened was, as soon as they ate it, they started toward death. And when you get toward death, the closer toward death you get, the more you suffer. Anybody in here older than 50 knows what I'm talking about, right? And so maybe a better word for you and me this day to understand what sin does is sin causes suffering, unneeded suffering, unwanted suffering. And so when you choose to let sin in your life, what you're choosing is this. You're choosing to suffer. Now, how many of you want to suffer? Right? Doesn't that make sense? God is always willing to forgive us, but there are often consequences to our sin that we still have to endure. When we mess up, we end up carrying this guilt. We end up carrying this shame. We end up carrying this whatever it is because we fell and we knew we shouldn't have. But listen, before you leave here today, if you're carrying guilt and shame and all that anxiety and stress, God has an answer for that. And before you leave here today, you have the opportunity to unhitch your wagon from that. You have an opportunity to be disconnected from that and reconnected to the Lord. Because here's the reason. Jesus can set you free. Jesus will set you free. The promise is that you can be holy. The promise is that I can be holy. Why? Because he is holy. That's the promise. Because he is holy, he will make me holy. God will never ask you to do something that he hasn't already done. God will never require you to do something that he hasn't already prepared you to do. God will never ask you to do something that he hasn't already gone before you to do it and has it ready for you. He's already made the way. So turn to your neighbor and say, you can be holy. So be holy. Now come on, people. Help me out this day. Help me out today. Turn to your neighbor and say, you can be holy. They need your encouragement. So say, be holy. You can be holy. You can do this. Not because of you, but because God's holy. He's already holy, and just choosing the Lord will make you holy. Just choosing to live your life like the Lord will make you holy. Be thankful. Be holy. And the next thing is, be loving. In this particular verse, it says unloving, and I've got that circled in my Bible because it's saturated. Everything in here is saturated with people who are unloving. We see unloving people all the time, don't we? Sometimes we act unloving because we're tired or lonely or discouraged or mad or whatever. We understand what it means to be unloving. We understand what it means to be unloved. We see that all the time. But real love is not feelings. A real love is agape love. Agape love is God's love, and it is the choice to do what is right in spite of how we feel. It's the choice to love people even when you don't think they deserve it. It's intentionally choosing to do something that's right, regardless of the cost. In the last days, one of the signs is that people are going to disregard life and the life of people. And we're living in an unloving generation right now. Our disregard for life right now is at an all-time high. And instead of loving, we bring selfish. Instead of loving, we're doing what's best for me. How many times have you heard, I don't care? I don't care anymore. I don't care about this. I don't care about that. I don't care about you. How many times? And this mentality sucks the life right out from us because of that. Because of that. Because of that, I'm going to choose to be different. Because of that mentality, because of that concept, I'm going to choose to love. Because of that, I want to choose to be loved, to receive love. Because if I can get it from my Lord, I can give what he's given. I may not can give it if I don't have it, but I can receive it from my Heavenly Father. And if I can obtain that, then I can issue that. I can distribute that. I can give it out. Not based on my idea. Not based on my value system. Not based on my idea of worth. You see, human beings, humankind, all men, women, boys and girls are made in the image of God. Can I get a witness? So therefore, because they are made in the image of God, they deserve to be loved by God, by you. All doesn't matter race, nationality, doesn't matter type of religion. We are all called to love people. That's what Jesus did. He set the example. And there's this great word that you may or may not want to write down, but it's called compassion. And it is the word that separates Jesus from every other great teacher, great prophet, great whatever, great religion. Jesus always showed compassion to the compassionless people. He always showed compassion to the people who did not deserve it in the eyes of most people. Jesus always distributed compassion even when he was tired, lonely, and discouraged. And he calls us to do the same. So be thankful, be holy, be loving, and the last one is be forgiving. Be forgiving. The word there is unforgiving. The reason we don't forgive is we don't understand forgiveness. We don't understand the concept of forgiveness. We think that we're United States of Americans. I'm American. So because I'm American, I got the right not to forgive. It's what we think. Our culture has influenced our beliefs. And the reality is, it doesn't matter what you have done or haven't done, I get to choose whether or not I forgive you. And we think forgiveness means I'm okay with what you did, or I'm going to sweep it under the carpet, or we're not really calling it what it really is. You don't know how bad you hurt me, so if I say I forgive you, then I'm okay, I'm condoning what you've done, and that's not it at all. Truth of the matter is forgiveness has little to do with the person who harmed you, but it has everything to do with setting you free from the guilt and the pain and the suffering and the sin and the emotions and the thoughts and all the things that come with that. Forgiveness enables you to unhitch your wagon to be pulled back into that mess. It doesn't let them necessarily go free. It just sets you free. And Christians today, folks, I love you enough to tell you the truth. We do not do a good job of forgiving. We need to get better at forgiving. And I'm going to make the hard choice today of being someone who forgives. I'm going to choose today to forgive those who harmed me because they just wanted to get me out of the way. I'm choosing today to forgive and to practice that. Listen, this is huge because every Christian has their heart polluted by unforgiveness. We don't practice this, but when we do practice this, we discover what I'm talking about. You experience what it is that I'm asking you to do. How many of you know churches that split because of unforgiveness? How many of you know marriages that have split because of unforgiveness? Friendships. Horrible, horrible things. All because of unforgiveness. Can I just remind you that we don't war against people? Our war is not against flesh and blood. Our war is a spiritual battle. Satan is our enemy. Jesus is the victor. And he has given us the ability to have victory. And that victory comes from forgiveness. And so I challenge you, as I have challenged myself today, make the hard choice. Do what the Father has already done. Do what the Father has exemplified through Jesus. And that is offer forgiveness to those who don't deserve it. Set the captive free, because you'll find out that captive is really you. My job today is to get you to see that the first principle is to truly fall in love with Jesus. When life is horrible, the number one thing that you can do is go back to Jesus. Come on, somebody. No matter how dry your spiritual life is, no matter how dusty, no matter how cold, no matter how empty your spiritual life is, the number one answer is to always go back to Jesus and rediscover that first love. The number two solution is recognizing that your decisions about your life and about your conditions of your heart affects more than just you. More than just you. And because it affects more than just you, make the hard choice. Make the hard choice. It really is up to you. John 10:10 says this. Listen, I love this. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy, but Jesus says, I've come to do what? Amen. Give life. Give abundant life. I have come that you might have life to the full. Those are Jesus' words. But they're offered only through this concept, through this idea that we must choose Christ. So how do I fix this? How do I do this? Nehemiah 8 says, the joy of the Lord is your strength. That may sound weird to you. You're like, where in the world are you getting that? Why does that come from? I want to ask you today, number two questions. How much joy do you have? How much strength do you have? And you're going to find there's a correlation, there's a relation, there's a relationship between the two. your joy has been stolen, and because your joy has been stolen, you can get mugged today by a butterfly. You'll get that tomorrow. You'll be at lunch tomorrow, and you go, oh, that's what Mark meant. Okay, yeah. You have no strength because you've lost your joy. You can't even protect yourself because you don't have the strength that God has gotten or given you. So listen, ask yourself this question. What's going on inside of me? Ask yourself this question. What is the Lord saying to me? When you focus on the Holy Spirit or looking for the Holy Spirit, you'll lose focus on the external stuff, and you'll start discovering joy. When you find the Spirit, you always find joy. Always find joy. So focus on Him. So to do that, right, this is in your outline, okay? I'm finally getting to where I'm supposed to be, okay? Here we go. Number one, make the choice to be like Jesus every day. All those things that I said up there, the summarize that is make the choice to be like Jesus every day. Now listen, now here's the reality. We do it sometimes. We're really good sometimes, but God says do it every day. Make the choice every day to be like Jesus. And so life, somebody said this. I've got this written down. I just saw it. I wish I could claim this quote, but I'm not this quote, but I'm not that smart. Life is 10% of what happens to you and 90% how you respond to that. Isn't that true? Life is 10% what happens to you and 90% is what. Listen, there's nothing inside of me that wants to change my attitude. I like it when I get mad. When I get mad and angry and upset and want to beat somebody up, it makes me feel like a man. You get this testosterone and blood flowing, it just does. I'm being honest. And every male in here can say, yep, that's me. I'm with you. Because that's our reality. That's what we want to do. But the answer isn't me getting mad and busting somebody's nose. The answer is me saying, all right, Lord, I need you to deal with this the way that you want me to deal with this. I am not entitled to a bad attitude because I've had a bad day. I'm not entitled to that. I'm entitled to be like Christ because that's who He's called me to be. Hebrews says it this way. Let us throw off. I love that. I love the image. Throw it off. Everything that hinders you. That sin that so easily entangles you. And you know what your sin is. You know what your habit, your hurt, your hang-up is. You know what it is by now. Throw it off. And run with perseverance the race that God has for you. God's got a call for you. God's got a purpose. He's got a plan. He created you. He designed you in a unique way so that you could fulfill what it is that He needs you here on earth for. Get this. God looked down on this earth, or he was walking among the earth. He didn't look down. He's always here. And as He's walking around, He saw a problem. And He said, I need to fix this problem. And I'm going to create Tyler Harris just so he can be a solution to this problem. There's a problem here on this earth. I'm going to design Tyler just the right way. In the right way, he's going to be gifted in this. He's going to have strength in that. He's going to have weakness in this because I don't need him doing this other stuff. That's not what I want him doing. I need him doing this. And so I've created him this way so that he can walk among the earth and his friends and his peers and influence the people that I bring into his life. Amen? God's done that for you. So throw off all the things that hinder you and walk the call that God has given you to walk. You can't control what happens to you. You can't, but you can control your response. Psalm 19 says it this way. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock, my redeemer. My rock, my redeemer. So make the choice to be like Jesus. Number two, learn to appreciate life. Again, summarizing those four or five things I ask you to do. Learn to appreciate life. Develop this high appreciation for life. What's your life's philosophy? Is your glass half full or is it half empty? Are you an optimistic or are you pessimistic? You see, that really does matter. And the belief that you have that even in bad days, God will work it out for the good affects your decisions. Do you really believe that in spite of you having a bad day, that God will use all things for the good? Or are you going to fight and resist all the bad things that are happening that day? You're going to focus on the bad things that are happening that day. I challenge you. Learn to appreciate life. And one of the ways that you can learn to appreciate life is even in your worst moments. Say, I don't know why God has got me here. I just know He's got me here. Would you say that with me? Say, God's got me here. Say it with me. God's got me here. I don't know why I'm here. I don't know what He's doing. But God has me here for a purpose. And I'm going to do it in a way that honors him. I'm going to do it in a way that gives glory to him. My wife and I, we were talking last night. I'm so blessed. And I'm not just saying this, guys. I'm so blessed to have my wife. But when we first got married, we were opposites. We were like polars. I liked sports and she didn't. You know, I mean, I can go out in the gamut. And we struggled. We struggled. But here's what I realized. That those struggles brought us closer together. Those valleys caused us to trust each other even more. Those difficult times when we had each other's back created this trust that we would have never experienced, encountered, or wouldn't have today if we had not gone through those moments. I want you to hear this. There's a purpose for your valley. If you're going through a hard time or a hard day, no, God has your back, and he's allowing you to go through it because he wants to create something in you that never existed before. Be grateful. Look at that opportunity in life and say, Lord, I want to appreciate. My life really stinks right now, but I'm going to say thank you, Lord, because there's going to be a day when you get me out of this moment, and I'm going to look back and I'm going to say, man, I sure don't want to be there again, but I sure am glad that you let me go through it because of what you've done in me and what you've done through me. 1 Thessalonians says, give thanks in everything, give thanks, for this is the will for you in Christ Jesus. Be thankful. Appreciate life. Number three, look for Jesus in every situation. Find him in everything you do. He's there. His promise to you, he'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. He'll never turn his back on you. He won't do it. So look for him. And often, though, here's the deal. There's this little prayer, that this little guideline to prayer. Ask and you shall. Come on, Christians. Seek, and you shall knock, and it will be. In order for me to find him, sometimes I've got to do what? Knock, seek, and ask. He's not always just readily available for me. He needs me to go for him. He needs to see my motivation. He needs me to know if I'm in this or not. And he already knows, but he's allowing me to go through this so that I can find out who I am and where I am. And he asks me to do these things. Sometimes I got to seek him and seek for him. Paul writes in Philippians 4, finally, brothers, whatever true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Look for Jesus. That's what he's saying. Whatever your moment is, look for Jesus. Retrain your mind, and especially with people. I wanted to share this earlier, and I didn't write this story down, but this is a retraining moment for Mark. There was a time, like, I'm really old, so you kids, please don't do this, all right? Children, teenagers, if you're driving, or 20-year-olds, if you're driving, do not do this. Turn to your neighbor and say, don't do this. All right. So 135 years ago, I was driving down 25th Street here, right where Walmart kind of is. It wasn't there then. And I was in a little white sports car, and I just gotten saved. And I pulled over, and I picked this guy up. This guy had a trench coat on. It was rainy and wet. And he gets in my car, and my car starts smelling really bad. But I want to bless the Lord. I want to bless somebody with Jesus. I mean, the Lord has changed my life radically. And so I'm sitting here, and I'm just trying to talk to him and trying to love him, and my car is really starting to stink, and man, you know, it's not good. So I take him to where he wants to go, and I said, man, can I help you with anything else? And he said, well, would you have a couple bucks on you? I said, I don't know. So I checked my wallet, and all I had was a 20. I gave him that 20. Now, back 135 years ago, 20 was a lot of dollars. $20 was a lot of dollars, a lot of money. But I gave it to him. When he got out of the car, I was just boasting. I was by my chest. Oh, man, can you believe, Lord, what I just did? Look what I just did. And that stink still stunk. It was still there, right? I mean, it was bad. And this is the embarrassing part. So I go to my roommate, and I'm telling my roommate about, let me tell you what the Lord just did with me. Let me tell you what I, and I'm telling him how I picked this person up that was homeless and carless, and how, you know, I'm so good. That was the message. I'm so good. But I was like, man, it just stinks. Gosh, something stinks. And he goes, Yeah, you're right. Something does stink. Your attitude. And I was like, it was my roommate, so I throat punched him and I hammered down on him. I showed him who stunk then, but I had to get home and meditate on that a little bit and realize it was me. That God had to retrain my mind because I thought I was doing something good, and I was doing something good, but I did it in a way that didn't honor God. And I wonder how many times we think we're doing something good or right, but our motive is wrong. And because our motive is wrong, we think we're honoring God, but the reality is we're getting all the glory, and God's not. Number four, do all that you do and then trust God. Do all that you know to do and then trust God with the rest. Trust God in everything that you do. The problems that you have in life right now, listen, if you do everything that Mark Elkin says for you to do, if you take this home and you ingest it, you digest it, and you apply it, guess what? You are going to have a bad day. Turn to your neighbor and say, you're going to have a bad day. This is not the promise of the gold ring and all this sort of stuff, all right? You are going to have a bad day. And so when that day comes, listen to me, you're going to have problems, you're going to do all this. How are you going to get through this? How are you going to resolve this? I thought I was doing the right thing, and now I'm still broke. I thought I was doing the right thing, and man, I'm still being drawn to this. Lord, I'm trying my best to be right with you, but I find myself still failing. What is going on, Lord? Here's what it is. God's saying, I need you to trust me. In spite of what you're saying, I need you to trust me. In spite of what your feelings, I need you to trust me. You might want to say it this way. God's promise is greater than your experience. God's promises are greater than your experiences. Jesus, on his worst day, hanging on a cross, he said this. He said, Lord, into my hands I give you my spirit. I trust you. I trust you. One of the reasons we're not happy is because we don't know how to handle hard times. We haven't learned how to trust God in the midst of those difficult moments. In Philippians 4, the Bible teaches, do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your request to God, and get this, and the peace of God. Here's your promise. Peace of God. You already have peace with God, and when you have peace with God through Jesus, you get the peace of God to live your life through. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. You can leave your problems at the feet of Jesus and walk away peace-filled. Peace-filled. But it can't be your problem and God's problem at the same time. It can't be. God will not work that way. It's either you give it to him or you take it. When you give your life, you get the peace with God. When you give your problems, you get the peace of God. Cast all your anxiety upon him. Why? He cares for you. Philippians, cast all, or 1 Peter, cast all your anxiety upon him because he cares for you. Throw your anxiety on him. We need to fall in love with Jesus so that we can choose to have an attitude like Christ. That's the ultimate choice. The ultimate hard choice is choosing to have the attitude of Christ. Listen to what it says in Philippians 2. I'm going to shut it down here. Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus. Woo! Your attitude should be the same as that of Christ Jesus. And I'll let you read the rest of that on your own at a later time. God made me to be like Christ. God wants to make you to be like Jesus. It's not impossible. It's his plan. He wants us to be like Jesus. That's his goal. That's his idea. He wants to transform you into being like Jesus. The choice is yours. Will you let him or will you deny him? Would you bow your heads with me? Father, I want to say thank you. Thank you, Lord, that you have given us this blessing, this calling, this plan. And through the process, Lord, we've discovered that it is your plan, that you've gone before us and you've made the way, that you're not going to ask anything from us that you already haven't done for us, that you're not going to provide anything, that you're not going to expect us to provide anything, that you've already provided it. We just need to trust you to give it to us when we need it, that you prepared the way and you prepared our lives. Father, I pray that we would have the faith today to choose you. You've given us a choice, life or death. You've given us a choice, unholiness or holiness. We get to choose. Father, I pray that we would choose Jesus. I pray that we would choose Christ and that we would make the hard decision today to follow in obedience. And if God is speaking to you today and you choose Jesus, His promise is, first and foremost, that He will wash away your sins. His promise is that He will cleanse you and make you right with Him. That if we confess our sins, that He is faithful and just to cleanse us from all our unrighteousness. There is no sin too big for God. There's no sin too big that He can't forgive you, that He can't cleanse you, that He can't make you whole. Are you lacking joy today? Are you lacking strength? The joy of the Lord is our strength. Your joy, your strength come from the same faucet, but it requires you turning it on. You going to the Father and laying your anxieties at His feet and saying, Lord, this is no longer my problem, but it's yours. I'm just wondering today if there's some Christians here, Christ followers, you know you're going to heaven. But man, you're being robbed of life down here on earth. And today, maybe for the first time in a long time, you want to come back to this Father that loves you so dearly. You want to commit your life to a deep. If that's you, would you just raise your hand? I'm not going to embarrass anybody today. God bless you. Anyone else want to say, yeah, that's me? That's me. I've lost my joy, I've lost my strength, and I want it back. Anyone else? Maybe there's someone here today that you know that when we talk about saved or salvation or new life or born again, that's not you. You're convicted right now. What is that? I want this new life. If today you want to pray a prayer that you want this new life and you don't know what to do, you can pray a prayer. It's not your words. Your words don't save you. It's the intent of your heart. Do you mean this? You can just simply say, Lord Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Come into my life and be my Savior. Be my Lord. In Jesus' name. If you prayed that prayer, would you just raise your hand? I promise I'm not embarrassing anybody. If you prayed that prayer, would you just raise your hand? Anybody at all in here? I bless you. Yeah. Anyone else? Anyone? Father, you know the minds and the hearts of each person that's here today. My prayer is that we do make that hard decision to choose you, to choose life, not death, to choose you, to choose the holiness, not the unholiness. Father, we forget that sin separates us from you, and we don't want to be separated from you. We forget, Lord, that our sin causes us to suffer unnecessarily. No one wants that. Lord, would you enable us to make that choice for you today? In the mighty name of Jesus. And everybody said, amen. We're going to stand, if you would, sing. And if you're going to stand as you're standing, maybe you want to come and be prayed for, be prayed with. Come and lay your problems at the feet of the Lord. Right down here, guys, our altar. We encourage you to come as we sing this song.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father. Thank you.
Church. Oh, you know, be seated for just a moment. We'll go over some announcements for us before I let us go. Get it all open here. All right, first and foremost, if you guys notice at the bottom of your outline, the King's Army is still in need of food for our food pantry there. There's a list out at the welcome table that has some suggestions and a box that you can drop those off in. So be praying about that and bring something to contribute to that ministry. And then on the inside now, we got our next ministry step class immediately following the service. It's right past the welcome table. Also, ladies' fellowship dinner at 6 p.m. at Cracker Barrel. All ladies are encouraged to attend for a night of food, fun, fellowship. So see Miss Marge for more details. That's going to be good. I really like some gravy. So too bad I don't get to go. So you women taking all the good food. Anyway, March the 11th, I heard some chuckles, though. That's encouraging. March 11th, the Children, Youth, and Adult Wednesday Night Services at 7 p.m. All are encouraged to attend those. March 12th, we have Celebrate Recovery at 6:30. Anyone with a hurt, habit, or hang-up is encouraged to attend. See Ms. Vonnie for more information. Remember, our Ministry Step classes, they continue. So if you've been through one, go to the next one. And if you accidentally skipped one, don't worry, it'll come back around. But be in prayer for those. Then on March 15th, join us at 3 p.m. as we celebrate and congratulate David Hall and Debbie Wilder on their upcoming marriage. So that'll be fun. And then March 21st, Student Servant Saturday for all youth in college. See John Tuttle for details. And then look at the big Easter weekend celebration on April the 11th. The time will be determined. Join us for a time of food, fun, and fellowship. We are in need of plastic eggs and candy to prepare for the egg hunt, and because I really want candy, so that's going to be good. I'm allowed to participate in that, right? Okay, just watch your kids, because I'll try not to hurt them. I really like candy, so there will be a donation box in the foyer, so anyway, I promise I won't hurt your kids. So my wife won't let me eat the candy, so that's right, no. With that said, let me pray for us, and we'll be dismissed today, but I hope you guys have a blessed week, and that we all get some extra nap in later today to make up for that hour we lost and ready to go. So let's pray together. Most gracious Heavenly Father, I thank you so much for this morning, Lord, and the time that we can come and just worship you in spirit and truth. And Lord, now as we leave these walls, Lord, let us continue to do that worship, Lord, in what you're calling us to do. And Lord, help us spread your joy to all those we come in contact with. And we thank you in advance for all that you're going to do this week. Be with each of our first-time visitors and guests, Lord. If they need to talk to anyone, Lord, help them know that Pastor Mark's out there, myself and my wife and John at the table here, to bring their connection cards to us, Lord, and just to talk, to get to know us more or get to know more about you. And Lord, we just give you glory and thank you in advance for everything you're going to do in each one of our lives this week that we can't even comprehend. And so, God, we give you the glory and ask your hand of protection as we leave now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.